Well, good evening, and welcome to St. Rose and the celebration of the 18th Sunday in Ordinary Time. Our opening hymn is Love Divine, All Loves Excel.
Jesus, you are the Son of God and the Prince of Peace. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you are the Son of God and the Shepherd of us all. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you are the Son of God and the Son of Mary. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us all of our sins, and bring us one day to everlasting life.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest.
Peace to
the people of the world. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, heavenly King, O God, Almighty God. Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son. Lord God, Man of God, Son of the Father. You take away the sins of the world,
have mercy on us.
You take away the sins of the world.
Receive our prayer.
You are seated at the right hand of the Father.
Have mercy on us.
For you alone are the Holy One.
You alone are the Lord.
You alone are the Most High,
Jesus Christ.
With the Holy Spirit,
and the glory of God the Father.
Amen.
I can tell this mess is going to be fun. That's just our broken light system, which goes on and off. It may come back on, it may not. Believe it or not, we've been dealing with this issue for almost 3 weeks. One technician comes, spends the morning with us, and says he can't do anything. And he's one of the persons who installed it 25 years ago. And then we asked him, well, when are you going to come back? He goes, in about a week. And then the second person came in about a week, and he was here all day, and he wanted to leave. And same thing, he said, in about a week. We do have someone coming to look at it, but it scares me to even think about it because it's beginning to look like the whole system is broken. And right now we're talking to the roofers looking for who's going to get that job. So it's sort of just bad luck. Anyway, it's given us 25 years of good service, so one doesn't have obsolescence built into it these days. Well, let us pray. O God, protector of those who hope in you, without you nothing has a firm foundation. We ask that you draw near to your children gathered here and answer our prayers with unceasing kindness, that for those who glory in you as our Creator and Guide, that you will keep us safe and you have restored us through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Thus says the Lord, all you who are thirsty, come to the water. You who have no money, come, receive grain and eat. Come without paying and without cost. Drink wine and milk. Why spend your money for what is not bread, your wages for what fails to satisfy? Heed me and you shall eat well, you shall delight in rich fare. Come to me heedfully, listen that you may have life. I will renew you, the everlasting covenant, the benefits assured to David. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Responsorial. The hand of the Lord feeds us. He answers all our needs. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and of great kindness. The Lord is good to all and compassionate toward all his works. The hands of the Lord feeds us, he answers all our needs. The eyes of all look hopefully to you, and you give them their food in due season. You open your hand and satisfy the desire of every living thing. The Lord is just in all his ways and holy in all his works. The Lord is near to all who call upon him, to all who call upon him in truth.
Amen. The Lord is near to all.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, what will separate us from the love of Christ? Will anguish, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or the sword? No, and all those things we conquer overwhelmingly through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor present things, nor future things, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
hold the gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord.
When Jesus heard of the death of John the Baptist, he withdrew in a boat to a deserted place by himself. The crowds heard of this and followed him on foot from their towns. When he disembarked and saw the vast crowd, his heart was moved to pity for them, and he cured the sick. When it was evening, the disciples approached him and said, "This is a deserted place, and it's already late. Dismiss the crowds so that they can go to the villages and buy food for themselves." Jesus said to them, "There's no need for them to go away. Give them some food yourselves." But they said to him, "Five loaves and two fish are all we have here." Then he said, "Bring them here to me." And he ordered the crowds to sit down on the grass. Taking the five loaves and the two fish, and looking up to heaven, he says a blessing. He broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples, who in turn gave them to the crowds. They all ate and were satisfied. And they picked up the fragments left over, 12 wicker baskets full. Those who ate were about 5,000 men, not counting women and children. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
You've come here for Mass, so don't let the lights distract you. Don't go along with it. That's like Satan doing that to us. Today is that David? Is that you right in front of me? David or Peter Brockman? No. The crowd, you guys look like someone I know. I don't want to be mistaken. Times are different. And they're so mixed up. But we know we're smart people. And we know that it's going to end. It's not forever. I know every time you turn on the TV, or at least I feel every time I turn on the TV, there's a group of people saying it's the end of the world, and another group of people on the other side saying it's a new beginning for the world. And then most of the people are sort of in the middle. And it's hard to sort of keep up with it. I seen a little girl last night on TV. I'm not sure what state she was from, but it was a southern state, and her brother had just gotten on the school bus. He was in sixth grade. The mother was very nervous, first day of school, and his slightly older sister, who was in eighth grade, she wouldn't go. She wouldn't get on the bus. There were people there with the TV cameras, so they sort of interviewed her. She was sitting on the couch in her living room. The more the man asked, the more frightened she became, and then she just started to cry. And you could see on her face, that from talking to someone being occupied, that she just suddenly became overwhelmed with fear. Fear. Fear is the absence of love. In our scripture, love casts out fear. Letter of St. John. And I know our kids are thinking, I mean, you know, everybody's different. Some kids can't wait to get back to UMass. They heard they're going to be virtual classes only. They're going to be living in their dorm with nothing to do all day. That they can't wait for that. As I was talking to my mother this morning, whose son is in that crowd, she's just praying that the police car drives up and down the street. They and thousands of other people live on. There's fear there also. We're teaching our kids to learn, I think, to be resilient. And we are resilient, aren't we, Americans? And we can get through this. But it's amazing when we get so distracted. I mean, people must laugh at us when we're fighting over the face mask. And that's like a little private war, public war in our country now. People shoving and pushing those who have and those who don't. And they just don't want to be told what to do. And that's real scary. that impact all of us. There's just so many losses. Like in the gospel today, Jesus feeding, you know, some people estimate, believe it or not, you know, even how there are big crowds in the Middle East, there were then also. Some people say it could have been 20 or 30,000 people. And he tells us, sit down. First of all, he's going there to this field, this pasture, because he's tired. In this gospel, Jesus is worn out. He withdrew to a deserted place by himself. Why? Because John the Baptist had just been beheaded. That's his cousin and his close friend. So he's grieving, and he wants to get out of there and get some rest with his disciples. But they find out where he's going, and the vast crowd meets him there. And his heart was moved to pity. That's one of my favorite expressions of the gospel. Because imagine the Lord of all being moved to pity. He has everything. He is everything. His Father is our Creator, God our Father. Jesus loved his friends so much, especially his cousin, who was in jail. They're waiting to see if he could get out. And you know the story. Because of a silly dance, they beheaded him. And then the other line I like too is the disciples are telling him, we need to get rid of these people so they can go get some food. It's late. The vendors will close probably. And what does he say? And they have nothing with them. He says, do it yourself. Stop asking other people to do everything for you. You go feed them. That's what he said to them. Go feed them by yourselves. Enough of that. Everyone here should get involved. We need everyone here to have the banquet with two loaves, or five loaves and two fishes. And we know that after dinner, a hearty dinner, they had 12 big baskets left. Don't ever doubt that God will bring us to completion. Don't ever doubt, despite all the reasons why we might, that God is leaving us. God is more with us than ever before. I think one of the problems is for us these days that, you know, there's an economic crisis, there's a health crisis, too many people are upset, there's terrible suffering going on. You know, when I pray, it's sort of like praying over an empty church. Like I told somebody, whenever I go over to Lowe's, which is often, at least almost once a day, at least, when you go to Lowe's next time, turn around and look at your parish church. This beautiful church, because it looks so sad. I stand there, you know, when you're in line, you have to wait. I say a prayer for all of us, that this beautiful church will really be restored to its proper place in the lives of our people. And I stand there and think, people are trying everything we can to get through this virus. You need to come back to God. I think it's time for Catholics to consider their level of comfort and consider coming back to church gradually. Because I think what so many of us are missing in our life, something there's a certain strength or wherewithal that seems missing from our lives. And I think it's the Eucharist, it's the body of Christ, that all those people out there are right now without the energy, the love, the charisms, the Holy Spirit, that comes when we take Holy Communion. And for all of us here today to think of how powerful that is in a conversion, soon you will be able to feed the 5,000 yourself. You won't have to tell Jesus, go get the bread and the fishes. We'll do it ourselves. I think what's missing, and you figure this out, talk about it tonight or tomorrow, I think what's missing is joy, a sense of joy. There's so much overwhelming us that I think the best of us is not happy. And joy is the essence of Christianity. It's what makes us Christian. Joy. The Easter joy, that's where it's born, the resurrection. We don't need to go back and trace that. But that's where it comes from. The joy of a Catholic or Christian witness. It's our witnesses, our light that is on, our candle that's burning, that brings joy to others. That's why people become Catholics, because they're moved by some event. See how much they love one another, is the quote from the script. See how much they love one another? They're filled with joy. That's why they love one another. It's not that hard or complex to get. They're just joyful. So let's think of joy also comes from the Eucharist. What does St. Paul say? What does he say? He says, otherwise, we are a clanging cymbal, making a lot of noise, but not a living witness to Jesus Christ. All of these people who were fed and went home became involved. They became joyful. Because Jesus, who had every reason to send them away, the loss of his cousin, but his heart was moved to pity. We, if our hearts are not moved to pity, we should ask questions about the condition of our heart. Because if the current crisis in the world doesn't move us to pity, I don't think anything ever will. So let's stand for our prayer of the faithful. And we pray, Lord, here we ask you to open our hearts. Help us place all of our needs, all of our hopes, prayers, and desires in your loving hands.
For the church, that we may welcome all who hunger for meaning and purpose into our assembly, where they can be nourished by the word of God and the bread of life. For the world, that peoples of differing cultures may recognize our common humanity as we sit down together at the banquet of life, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For teachers, parents, and students, as the school year approaches, that God will give them wisdom and insight as they review their options and choose the best way to learn this year. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick, particularly those with COVID-19, that God will relieve their pain, restore them to wholeness, and guide all who are caring for them. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all the faithful departed, especially John McCarthy, for whom this Mass is offered, may they be raised up on the last day to live forever. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Gracious Lord, hear these prayers and all the prayers of our hearts through Christ our Lord. Let us pray that our sacrifice will be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
Lord, accept the sacrifice from your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all this holy church,
Lord, we pray that you bless these gifts and accept them along with our prayer and our hope to make each one of us an eternal offering to you through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
Loving Father, all over the world your people praise you. So now we pray with the whole church, with Francis our Pope, Robert our Bishop, in heaven the Blessed Virgin Mary, Joseph our husband, all of the apostles and saints, Saint Rose of Lima, and all those who sing your praise. Now we join with them and with all the angels to adore you as we say. When the supper ended, he took the cup filled with wine. Again he gave you thanks and praise. He gave the cup to his friends and said, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant. It will be shed for you and the many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Spirit.
day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, from every kind of evil, and graciously grant peace in our days. That by the help of your mercy, we will always be free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
The kingdom and the power and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus, you said to your friends, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you." Look not on our sins, but on our faith and our hope, and grant us the peace and the unity of your kingdom, where you live forever and ever.
Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
And now let's just offer someone a sign of God's peace. Peace be with you.
In our communion name is behold the Lamb.
Your family, Father Christ,
dwell.
Our closing hymn is How Great Thou Art.